Good evening. Good evening. We'll give it just a moment for everybody to get in and sitting down. Welcome. Good evening. My name is Dave Sabathny, and I'm the president and CEO of the Western DuPage Chamber of Commerce. And on behalf of our board and our members, I'd like to welcome you here to the State of the City address here in Warrenville. You know, the business of business is not always an easy thing to do. It requires active, thoughtful partners, which we have enjoyed for years here in Warrenville. Warrenville is a great community, and they've been able to do some very unique things in striking balance. 13,134 residents. About 8,500 of those are between the ages of 19 and 64. There are 1,430 registered firms in Warrenville. So if you do those numbers, if you're one of those numbers guys, you'll like the fact that there's one company for every six working employees in Warrenville. What does that really mean? That means we need to bring people in from other communities in order to fill all of those jobs here in Warrenville, and we're very proud of that. The other balance that they've been able to strike is that we export, and you don't think of Warrenville, we're not an exporter, but what I mean by that is through the strong business that they've developed here, the commerce that they've developed, is being able to have the gas stations who are servicing people from somewhere else. The companies that are here in Warrenville ship to other places, but that revenue comes back here. So we are able to enjoy some benefits within this community of the taxes and the revenue that those companies generate to help support the services here in Warrenville. And that is not done easily, but Warrenville has done that and has achieved some great things. Warrenville, think about this. Of those residents, 92% have high school diplomas, in large part because of the quality of the schools. Almost 43% have bachelor's degrees or above. So 4 out of 10 of the people you pass while you're walking through the wonderful bike trails, enjoying parks, enjoying the library, probably have a degree, right? And that's a pretty special thing. We are equal to the median income of all of DuPage. We are almost a split mirror image of DuPage County. So when you think of DuPage County as being one of the strongest in the country, you are the mirror image of what that is. None of that happens by accident. You'll hear tonight of what it takes to have those things happen. In typical style, I will suspect that most of the credit will go to the staff, to the team here in Warrenville, the city councilmen, to the other taxing bodies, our schools, our fire districts, the library, the park districts, but the coordination of all that, the collaboration of that really is attributed to each of those organizations and to their leadership. That having been said, again, I'd like to welcome you here to the State of Warrenville address and remind us that none of these things are possible without the sacrifices that are made by our military and those in service to us. So if you will, please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance with me. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you so much, and without further ado, let me introduce to you Mayor David Brummel.
Thank you, David. Thank you so much, David. I really appreciate the Chamber sponsoring the event again, as you've done in the past. They've provided the refreshments for us that we enjoyed on the way in, so I appreciate that very much. I appreciate your presence tonight, and for all of those out there in internet land that are watching this on YouTube at a later date, welcome to you also. This is number 12 for me. If you know me, if you remember some of my past performances here, I'm a bit of a wordsmith. Usually I come in and I like everything decided ahead of time and it's all got to be written out. And like one of my columns, how many people read my column, by the way? Raise your hand if you do. Oh, that's so gratifying. Thank you so much. Well, I don't know if I can reach that high standard tonight. I'm going to find out. As it turns out, there's this new thing, this new system that they have that I want to try tonight that, you know, it's apparently just something new on the market. I believe it's called a PowerPoint. And we're going to experiment with that right out there on the cutting edge, flying blind, seeing how it's going to go. Alma turned me on to this. Alma Morgan, our trustee executive assistant, who is so full of good ideas. And when you see some really cool graphics, those are Alma. So we can thank her for that tonight. So we're going to do that. We're going to do a little bit of a hybrid. And we're going to do things kind of in two parts. I'm going to present to you some of the good things that have been going on in the community in the last year. And then I stole an idea from another mayor who, in his presentation, did a little bit of a retrospective of what had happened in the community at the time that he was mayor. So I've been mayor for 12 years. So I thought, well, let's do a top 10 list, but we'll have to make it a top 12 list because it's 12 years, right? You have to have some kind of symmetry there. So when you came in on your seat, you found a little ballot with a pencil. And what I will do is I'll make my presentation and give you an idea of what's going on in the last year. If you get bored or, you know, you want to do it now, or I'll give you a few minutes after I'm done with the first part of the presentation, rank those 12 things from 1 to 12, because that's what I'm going to do. We've had so many good things happen in our community over the years, it's hard to pick out even 12. You know, we started out with far more than that, and we winnowed it down to 12 so that we could have a little fun with that tonight. So I'd be interested to see how you rank the things that I picked as being very important over the last 12 years. And we'll do the countdown like they do on TV. We'll start with 12, 11, 10, 9, and we'll see how yours matches with mine. You don't have to put your name on it. It's not a test. It's just, and don't overthink it. Just take a quick look at it and see what you can come up with. And then if you turn them in at the end, leave them on the table, we'll tabulate things and we'll get a little thing on our Facebook page to let you know what other people thought. In addition, if you could think something on there that you think should have been included that wasn't, put it on there. I'd be interested to see what you see as something that's really good for the community. So, with that all being said, let's start off. Let's talk about some good things that have happened in Warrenville. The first thing I'd like to talk about are some staffing changes that we've had. We have a very stable environment here. We have a good team. We have people that are valued, that come. We treat them well. They stay a long time. But, of course, there are always changes. People find new opportunities. People move away, and new positions become open. So I don't want you to think that we hired 10 more people, but we have replaced 10 people very successfully because we have a good reputation as a community. We always get high-quality people to apply for our positions. So we have a new assistant city administrator. We have 4 new police officers. We have a chief code official, a building inspector, code enforcement officer, a senior civil engineer that's new, a deputy public works director, and a public works laborer. So all those folks are new to the organization. All of them come highly recommended and qualified for their positions, and we're excited to have them on board. So that's something that's very, very good for us going forward. We've also really amped up our social media presence. I think all of us have discovered, as part of any organization anywhere, that you have to go where the people are. You can't expect them to come and look for you anymore. So Facebook is something that we've begun, and we have an active presence on now. We have a page. We have 952 likes on our page and 953 people following. If you're not doing that, please do. It's a start for us. We found it to be very successful to get information out, and we've reached over 10,000 people at various times already since we started using Facebook. So we intend to do that more. If you were on our page tonight, you saw something about skunks, because this is the time of year that you wake up in the middle of the night and you go, oh my God, is he in the house? Some ideas from the Forest Preserve District on how to deal with those. We have YouTube videos, so you can go to YouTube also, City of Warrenville on YouTube, and you can find things that we've put there that are informational to help you understand what's going on in the community, maybe some problem that has been resolved, but it's a way to get out more information. All of our meetings are on YouTube, so that you can slip into your onesie late at night, get some Girl Scout cookies and a glass of milk, and you can watch any meeting that you want. You don't have to get dressed up and come here. We think, again, that's very important because you need to see your government in action and see the people that are making the decisions for you. We have 41 videos on YouTube as I stand here, and we've had an average of 36 views for those, for each of those, which is kind of nice. It's a start again. But we, again, have recognized that we have to go where people are. People are on Facebook. They're on YouTube. They're not necessarily going to go. They don't read as many papers as they used to or don't watch the news as much as they used to, but these are the places they are. We want to be there. We want to make sure we get good information out. Another very good thing that I'm happy to report year after year after year, and I hope I can always report this going forward, we have no bonded debt in Warrenville. That is very unusual for a community. It's very unusual for any government entity, I think. If the higher you go, the more unusual it is. Locally, there are a number of communities that are pretty close to that standard. I'm very proud of the fact that every penny that you pay in tax money is used for something useful in town, either staffing or services that we provide. None of it goes to debt service. You know, you hear a lot of talk about the LGDF, the state money that is basically a pass-through. They're supposed to collect it from municipalities and give it back. When we get our LGDF, which is about $650,000 currently, every single penny of that goes to providing services. None of it goes to debt service. So I'm very proud of our community for that. I inherited that situation from former Mayor Lund, and I like to say that all I have to do is not screw it up, and I'm doing my best. So going forward, our intention is always to remain that way. We have a balanced budget, of course. We're required to do that by the state ordinance or the state statute. We would do it anyway because it's the thing to do. It's what government should do. So we're proud of the fact that we always have a balanced budget. We have a diversified revenue stream, as you can see. That's really important. It doesn't happen by chance. Think of a community that depends on a huge car dealership for most of their revenue and the car dealership closes. What happens to that community? It doesn't work well. So what you try to do is make sure that you have a graph like we have up there so that if one thing leaves, you've got something else to take up the slack. I would note also that only 80% of our revenue stream is property taxes. So we've got most of our revenue from other sources. That's another thing that I think is noteworthy because a lot of those are discretionary expenditures. You have to pay your property taxes, but you don't have to have four cell phones, that sort of thing. You can turn your thermostat down for the gas. You have some choices involved. You don't have to go to a restaurant if you don't want to. So we tried to get taxes that involve discretionary spending so you had some control over how much tax you pay. So we have always been very, very careful with property taxes. And of course, when we went home rule in 2005, we promised you that we would abide by the tax cap, and we have every single year since then. So even though we have the power to tax more than the tax cap, we don't do that because we promised we wouldn't. So those are good things in terms of our finances. We have also, our community is changing demographically. We have more diversity than we've had in the past. Our city's minority population increased from about 26%. It's up to about 30% now. I'm proud to say that 32% of our police personnel are Spanish-speaking. Five officers, that's kind of nice. This is in recognition of the fact that we have people in our community that need that to be able to communicate, and the single most important thing in a community in terms of its safety is the ability of people to communicate with the police and with their government. So we've been very, very careful to make sure that our diversity is one of the things that we are proud of in the community, and we work to make sure that it works for us. We have some new development. That's always nice. 29 new single-family homes last year. 18 of those were in Herrick Woods. If you've been by Hubble Middle School lately, you see what's going on up there. A really, really nice development for us. We have 11 more new homes throughout the older areas of Warrenville. Virginia, Burke, Wilbur, Melcher, Riverview, and Townline all have new homes. The collective market value for these new homes is about $15 million. The nice thing about that is that that raises our EAV. When the EAV goes up, the individual taxpayer gets a better a better deal because you have to pay fewer taxes because there are more people to pay those taxes. So that particular $15 million probably lowered our individual tax bills by about $30 a year. So every time we get a bump like that, it helps you. Because there's a certain amount of money that's necessary for the government to function. Fewer people means everyone that's involved has to pay more. More people, you get to pay a little bit less. So this development is a huge plus for us, and it's heading in the right direction. A lot of the new homes have replaced older homes that were worn out housing stock. So it's an improvement for the community on that level also. We occasionally get awards. Not like Naperville, every other day they get another award, but we get them too because we do some things right. Some of them, you know, you would never think of. When I grew up in Warrenville, when I was a very small child, we were lucky to have a little mom and pop restaurant to go to. There really wasn't a whole lot. It was a very quiet little rural community. We have 6 hotels now. Can you imagine that? 6 hotels. And recently, Expedia ranked Warrenville number 12 of the 101 most comfortable cities for travelers in the country. Go figure. That's kind of nice. Yeah, it is nice. We have been ranked 3 times as among the safest communities in the state. Not just the safe community, but among the safest in the state. That's pretty impressive. That's a testament to our police department. It's a testament to our citizens who work closely with the police department. And we're very proud of that fact. And we were ranked 24th out of the 338 best suburbs to live in the Chicago area by niche.com. So we've gotten some nice things to indicate this is what we're all about. We're a nice little town. We treat people well, behave ourselves, and we're comfortable, which is a good thing to be, right? There are always things that we're looking for to improve. I mean, you can do a good job, but part of doing a good job is the recognition that there are areas that have to be worked on so that you can do a better job. We're working on right now in progress replacing some operating software that has pretty much lived out its life. If you're aware of IT type things, they only have a time span that they're valuable and then they become problematic. We're looking at our enterprise resource planning project to replace a 20-year-old data system that basically, unfortunately, works really well for one department but doesn't work across departments. So we're working on that solution at this time. That'll give us more efficiencies and a better reporting system and better operating processes. Always difficult transition to make, but it's something that you have to do. Periodically because IT solutions just keep changing and you have to try to keep up with that. We're proud that we're not on the cutting edge, but we're trying to get as close as we can to make sure things are done properly. We have over the years looked at every department in the city and tried to find ways to reorganize those departments to recognize that we have changed from a mom and pop organization to a more professional, policy-driven community, suburban community. That transition has to be made. We've been very successful as a mom-and-pop operation, but again, we have to make the change. Public Works is the last major department that we're looking at to make some changes in. We've done some studies to make sure we do the right thing. We've had a staffing and service level study to help us do that. Basically, we've also looked at the potential of another employee. This would be an additional employee. Public Works, our guys do a terrific job. There's no one in town who would ever say anything other than that. When it comes to snow plowing, when it comes to going to somebody's house at 11 o'clock at night when they have a water leak and helping them with it, all of those things, our guys do a terrific job. Whatever it is, they know what they're doing. They have to spend too much time doing paperwork. And if you know guys who like to do things, they don't like to do paperwork. They're good at doing things. So what we want to do is hire a professional that's going to help us in the department to do all that background work, to make sure that they're up on their training, make sure that happens, make sure that the records are kept properly, and to make sure that they are where they're supposed to be and keep track of their time so we have an idea of how their time is being spent and whether it's being well spent. So we're in the process of making that change for Public Works. I think you may not notice it because you interact with the guys out in the street all the time and they've been perfect all along. They're going to continue that, but they're going to get even better because they won't have to worry about some of that paperwork. That's the bane of their existence. um, Back to the police department for a moment. We've had 8 Narcan saves. That's been a wildly successful program throughout the county. Unfortunately, there is a huge need for that. It is probably scratching the surface because those saves don't necessarily mean that a life has been turned around. It means someone's been given a second chance. Whether they recognize that second chance is problematic because sometimes they don't. So more needs to be done, but we're doing our part that we're able to do in town by making sure our officers are prepared, and they've, again, saved 8 lives already. We have a national night out that has been nationally recognized. Again, in terms of awards, this used to be a little neighborhood program when I was an alderman. It worked just fine. We'd go from neighborhood to neighborhood every year and do a little program. We determined, you know, maybe better to make this citywide. So we started doing it citywide, and it has been wildly successful. Last year we had 1,400 people. It's a lot of fun. It's free food. It's a lot of booths. The fire department's there. The canine unit's there. A great opportunity for citizens to bring their families, be safe, have fun, and interact with our public safety first responders. So 2 out of the last 3 years, we were in the best in the nation for our size of community. Again, not just a letter of participation from the folks who do this, but here, you met these metrics, and you're among the best in the country. I'm proud of our police department for taking it on and making such a successful thing. We have a neighborhood roll call that's increased citizen participation. we're working on getting that even more successful in the future. If you haven't done it, give it a try. It's another way, again, to get up close and personal with the people that are protecting you and that you will see driving by every day. Every time you can make another connection, it helps them do their job better. I think the single most important metric, from what I've read, in terms of safe communities, is that communication between law enforcement and citizens. Extremely important. So we're trying to foster that as much as we can. The safest communities do that the best. And we certainly intend to improve as we move along with that program. Back to development again. We have established the Southwest Route 59 Corridor Tax Increment Financing District number 4. A big mouthful, but also a big, big thing. We've identified about a 300-acre area of our community that has languished. It has not really done much for the last several decades because of many, many issues, a lot of infrastructure issues. The first part of the problem is to recognize it. The second part is to realize that in order for that to change, the community has to get involved. One of the best ways that we have found, and we've been very successful with TIF districts, is to use a tax increment financing district. So we've established our 4th. Our first 3 were very successful. The TIF number 1, of course, is Cantera. I'm sure you're all familiar with that. That's already in the textbooks as one of the most successful in the state. So we know how to use these things. We know how to make that increment pay in terms of infrastructure, to improve these areas with improvements that simply would not have happened if we waited for the private sector to do them, and they wouldn't happen in a coordinated way that would be in the best long-term interest of the community. So the idea, again, of using a TIF is to take an area that is not going to redevelop in a positive way and give it that push so that it can. So we are definitely engaged in that effort at this point. It's over 300 acres, as I mentioned. We hope that if it goes as well as it should, we'll be able to fund through that TIF $30 million worth of infrastructure improvements. Again, these are improvements that almost certainly would not have been made by the private sector. It allows us then to make this area more attractive for developers, and if it's more attractive, they're more likely to come and bring their businesses there. Ultimately, with those improvements, if the TIF again works out as we think, we're talking about a $300 million private investment along Route 59, ultimately. That's a nice chunk of change, you know, a million here, a million there, 100 million here, 100 million there. Before you know it, you got real money, right? So we're pretty excited at the prospects out there. Again, to take an area that has been basically frozen in time and to look at what it needs to be done and to make that possible and then to work to make it happen is part of what we do, and we're very proud of our efforts there. Part of that, again, very close to that, you've read already, I'm sure, or maybe even seen the people working on the Amazon Fulfillment Center that's going in. That's technically in Aurora, but it's surrounded by Warrenville. So that huge improvement has already had people calling, developers potential calling about redeveloping the properties around that that are in Warrenville. So this should be a really, really nice jump start for our TIF out there. Again, they're presently building it. We're going to get over $5 million of infrastructure improvements from Duke Realty, part of that project. So again, we're going to invest probably a few hundred thousand dollars. We're going to get $5 to $6 million of improvements through that investment. I would call that a pretty darn good return on investment. And we'll get a signalized intersection, also a new one, that will again make our properties more valuable and more desirable for people to come and bring us new businesses. Some prosaic things, you always have to have a few of those, but they're very, very important. Water and sewer utility extension projects on Warren Avenue, Iroquois Court, Glen Drive South, $2.4 million. I would emphasize again, we pay cash for that. That's not borrowed money. It's money that we put aside for these programs. Every year we have a program that we do some improvement somewhere, either it's roads, sewer, water, but they're all paid for cash, no borrowed money involved. The projects all come in typically on time and under budget, because that's the way we do things. These projects extended city utility services to over 40 residences, giving them the option to connect. Again, we're a small town, we don't force people to do anything. Those utilities will be there. If people sign up right away, they're typically given some sort of a special deal because they're signing up right away. If they want to wait, they can wait. If they want the next person to do it, they can do that. But it's there, and it helps improve property values and make city services better. Looking ahead, we got a bunch of things planned. As you can see, the bottom line, $11.8 million worth of improvements coming. The road program, which was established when I was an alderman, every road is in a 15-year cycle for maintenance and replacement and rebuilding. Again, that's responsible government. At the time, of course, when you institute these programs, they're not popular because generally they mean your taxes are going to go up a little bit. But over time, we could be thankful that people do that sort of stuff. I mean, everything that we enjoy right now, somebody sacrificed for at some point and said, okay, I'll bite the bullet, I'll pay a little more, let's do that. So we have a road program. We have all of these other projects that are coming up. Duke Realty, see what's happening out there. Williams and Mack Road Water Extension, we've been talking about with the Forest Preserve District for some time. But again, nearly $12 million worth of improvements, all paid for by cash. We have other things coming. I can't give you a lot of details on some of them. We're looking again at redevelopment of the Musselman property, which is that 4.25 acres between the library and City Hall. You may recall that we suffered a bit of a disappointment when David Weekly Homes basically signed on the dotted line. We had an agreement with them. They were all set to break ground, and then they determined that they were going to leave town. That was a nice development. It was a big disappointment for us. They entered the Chicago market like a bit of a bull, and they got their noses bloodied, and they hightailed it back to Houston. So unfortunately, we had to pay. The good thing is, the developer we're working with now is a local developer who's been in business for 40 years, and the development that this developer has is better than David Weekly's. It is a charming development. It fits the neighborhood. It's 27 single-family homes, very well done, very well thought out, so we're very excited at the potential that this new development has. So cross your fingers that if you come next year and I'm still here, I can say, hey, we got that done, and here's some pictures. We're really excited about that. We're excited about the potential for a trailhead here along the Prairie Path. We have, 30,000 people a day go by in the summertime. What they're going to see as they go through is the impression they're going to get of Warrenville. We want to give them a place that they're going to remember in a positive way. So as they pass through Warrenville, they'll go, oh, hey, this is a nice little town. Maybe I'll stay. Maybe I'll move here. Maybe I'll stay for lunch. Maybe that positive impression will translate into some new businesses. But the whole idea is, again, perception is reality in terms of your community. If people perceive you as a beautiful, nice, quiet, safe community, stable community, that's really important for all of us because our future depends on that. We've already secured $402,000 in federal funding for that, for design and construction. Another thing that I'm very proud of, our staff is really, really good at ferreting out money from outside the city, whether it be grant money, whether it's federal money, whether it's state money or county money. Our guys do the best job in the world, guys and gals, do the best job in the world of finding that kind of money. So this one is off to a good start with $400,000 to get it going. We also are talking with the Forest Preserve District. In fact, we have an agreement with them for a multi-use trail link on Mack Road to 59. From a key marsh. If you've ever tried to ride your bike up there, you know that Mack Road is not exactly the most bicycle friendly in the world. $564,000 of federal grant for funding for design and construction of that also. So we're off to a good start with that. Another great project that'll help people get out and about. this is the one I think that's going to be the biggest splash going forward. Cantera is pretty much built out at this point, but there is one large parcel that remains, Lot C2, 28 acres. It's on the southwest corner. You see the river there on my left, Winfield Road on the right, give you an idea where it's at. A developer closed on that purchase in the middle of January, a very well-capitalized large developer. And they're talking, we had already a courtesy review in front of this plan commission. Roughly, it'll be a multi-use development with a market value somewhere in the neighborhood of $200 million. That will be a nice cap for Cantera, won't it? Another development that, I guess there are a couple of really good things about Cantera ultimately. One, it secured the future of our community financially. And that was done without any detriment to the older part of the community. So we have this beautiful new development that did not negatively impact the other part of town. Two, it has provided us with things in town that we've never had before. A Target, all of the things that are there we may not have ever had without the success of Cantera. So this would be a wonderful crowning achievement to round out Cantera. Part of that is, we'll see, but it's pretty exciting at this point, and the details are still being worked out with staff. So that's something to look forward to. it's been 50 years since we incorporated as a city. That's hard to believe for the people that were involved. I wanted to highlight this because we're celebrating it for a number of reasons. One, we would not be here tonight had that not happened. We would probably have been carved up and parceled out to other communities that neighbor us. One of the big worries at the time, 50 years ago, was a new development going into the west of us called Weston. It is gone now. It has been absorbed by the National Accelerator Laboratory, but that was planned to be one of the biggest developments ever in the state at one point. We were unincorporated. What do you think would have happened as that thing grew and grew and grew? We probably would have been absorbed into that and there wouldn't have been a Warrenville. So a number of prescient, hardworking people got together and fought very hard to make sure that we would have the opportunity to remain Warrenville forever. Dwight and Vivian Lund were the principal people involved in that. I just want to highlight that this was not an easy fight. It was sometimes neighbor against neighbor. There were business people that suffered, their businesses suffered because they supported this and their neighbors did not. We need to recognize that 50 years ago, a number of really good people allowed us to be here to celebrate the great community that we have now that's Warrenville and is always going to be Warrenville. So we have a number of things planned for that celebration coming up. Those are already on the list. I like the one in the middle pretty much. The other ones are going to be fun, too, but Two Brothers has always been very supportive of our community. As a matter of fact, they have purchased 20 acres on the northwest corner of Route 59 and Route 56, and they're going to build a brand new facility there because they want to stay in Warrenville. Yeah, that's a win. Anyway, we're going to have a number of things. I invite you to come to all of those things. It's going to be a lot of fun. There will be probably some more announced. Our Historical Society is handling that for us in conjunction with the city staff. So, again, recognition. I think that sometimes we overlook that we take a lot of things for granted that other people paid a heavy price for. And we're here and we're enjoying our town, and somebody made that happen. We need to keep that in mind. Speaking of making things happen, I'd be remiss if I didn't take just a moment and say, you know, of course, staff, volunteers, elected officials, these people make a lot of good things happen in our town, and it wouldn't happen without them. In the past, I've enumerated all the names and everything, but you guys know who you are. I remember one staff person that we had a while ago who spent 7 years to get us a quiet zone. I wonder whatever happened to her. Yes. It takes tenacity, to say the least, a lot of times to accomplish things in government. It's not like business where you can make a decision and you just go with it. In government, there are hurdles and more hurdles and more hurdles. And our people work very hard for us. I would say without fear of contradiction that we have folks that could get a job anywhere. They're that good at what they do, and I'm very proud of what they do. And I'm gratified to be able to work with them every day. Now, for the fun part, I hope you all filled out your ballots. If you haven't, do it. I'm always thinking about the good things that happen in our town over time. I was glad that we could recognize some things for a longer period of time than just one year, because I'm the mayor, and I said, that's what we're going to do, and everyone said, sure, let's do it. So fill that out, and I'm going to start with number 12 and work my way down. District 200, thank you for coming. I know you have a board meeting. See you soon.
Thank you.
Okay. My number 12 is already up there. How did that happen? I looked away and there's number 12. If you know me, you know I'm a big biker and a runner, and this is close to my heart. One of the first things I did when I was elected mayor the first time was establish the Bicyclist and Pedestrian Advisory Commission to work on establishing more trails, connections, signage, all the good things that allow us to get out without driving our car and enjoy nature. We have a lot of nature to enjoy. There are three communities in DuPage County that are recognized as bicycle friendly, which is not just, again, another letter of recommendation or participation. There are a set of metrics to be recognized at the bronze level, which we are, that are about this thick. A lot of people work very hard to make those metrics come together, and I want to say that Naperville and Elmhurst are in really good company with Warrenville as a bicycle friendly community. I'm very proud of that. So that's my number 12 to start out. Number 11, national recognition for our National Night Out program. Again, to take a program that was very, very small, not unsuccessful, but not impacting the entire community, now it impacts the whole community. I invite you all to come to that. It is so much fun. There are so many families. Again, a great opportunity for police and fire to interact with citizens. We have free food. Target always produces a great number of hot dogs and hamburgers and all that good stuff, and they do that all for us. They're a great corporate member of our community. Very successful event. I'm proud of what the department has done with that. It's not something they're required to do. It's something that we determined was a good thing to do, and they've taken it and run with it and made it very, very successful. Number 10. Our park district has a new center. That was another fight. There were a lot of people that didn't think that was necessary. If you have been in Warrenville for any period of time, when Mary and I raised our kids here 30 or 40 years ago, when you wanted to do something, if you wanted special program for your kids, you had to go somewhere else because there was nothing here. We've gone from that to the park district that we have now, which does a terrific job. Go by, anytime they're open, the parking lot is always full. The building is full. People don't have to leave town to work out. They don't have to leave town to have their kids involved in various programming. They do a great job. We had a big part of that because that's TIF money. Remember we talked about TIFs early and how successful they can be? TIF money built that. would not be there without our successful TIF. And the recognition early on, the law has changed, the recognition early on that you could have a very successful TIF, you could put another TIF next to it. If they're contiguous, you can port money from the one TIF to the other. So we had a really, really successful TIF. We had another TIF that needed a lot of help, and the law allowed us to port that money and to make all those improvements in the older part of town. This is one of those improvements that we were able to do as a city because of our successful TIF in Cantera. Number nine, I talked earlier about tough decisions, you know, when we did our road program. Capital maintenance and replacement plan. We were, again, a mom-and-pop operation. Mom-and-pop operations go from one emergency to the next. You know, you really don't have enough in terms of resources to plan too far ahead. You just have to hope you get through the year. And I remember talking to Vivian about that many early years. At the end of the year, they just go, phew, we made it through another one. Well, we get to a point where we can't do that anymore. We can't operate that way. Again, the community is changing. It's evolving from that small town mom and pop operation. It has to transform into a professional, policy-driven organization. One of the things that you have to do is recognize you own a lot of stuff, a lot of trucks, a lot of curb and gutter, a lot of street lights, a lot of buildings. Those things, one, need to be maintained. Two, they need to be replaced eventually. So we inventoried everything of any value in the city above a certain amount, put it into a timeline, figured out how long it was going to last, put those places in where they belong, put in the money. That was the hard part because, again, I have to use that bad word, tax, but you have to have revenue to support that. That's where the tough decisions come in. We came up with a program with seven or eight different aspects of a little tweak here, a little tweak there, a little new tax here, a little difference there. We took it to the public. The public said, you know what, I like most of that, but this I don't like, that I don't like. Some of our businesses said, no, this is a bad idea. We changed it for what we heard from the people. All of a sudden, everybody said, yeah, that's a good idea. Now we have it. So now everything that we own is in the program to be maintained and replaced when it wears out. Again, that's what government is supposed to do, right? Now I'll add one more thing on top of that. We don't purchase anything that we can't pay cash for and that there isn't a revenue stream in the CMRP to maintain and replace. Think about that for a minute. Think if the state did that. We still might be in heart. Again, isn't that the way government is supposed to operate? Anticipate the needs, make sure they're taken care of. Now, for us, it's a little bit more of a tax burden. We have to pay a little bit more. In 25 years, there are going to be people saying, boy, I'm glad they did that because I don't have to worry about replacing that $50,000 truck. It's already in the program. Very proud of that. Number eight, in terms of impact on the community, one of the things that when I was running for alderman, part of my platform was I want people to be able to stay in Warrenville for whatever their needs are. They shouldn't have to leave town. Target has helped us enormously with that. We have a lot of good stores in town. That one is one of the most, I think when Ron Mentzer and I interviewed the manager a few years back, they were like the sixth highest in sales in the region. It's really, really happening place. It is an economic engine for our community, and it allows you to shop, again, without leaving town. People who come to the hotels go there. When they come to our hospital centers, they go there. It is just great to have. So for me, that's a huge building block to the success of our community because it keeps people in town. I've talked with people from Naperville who work out at Lifetime Fitness, and they say, well, I do my shopping before I go home, and I say, perfect. That's the way it should be. Work out, shop, go home. So Target, Super Target, a big, big thing for our town. Number seven. Recognize that one, Jen? Again, 7 years to get that. But if you lived anywhere over near the tracks, if you lived anywhere in town, I can still remember being out in McKee Marsh riding my bike, listening to the train whistles, waking up in the middle of the night, listening to the train whistles. I've done work in homes that were contiguous to the tracks. I can tell you, when you're kind of involved in something and one of those engines comes by and shoots that horn off, you're awake. You don't miss it. This was an enormous effort on Jen's part, but we got it. Now you don't hear them anymore. That's a huge plus for the community. Number six, the Williams Road Bridge, not just because I live on the other side of it. This was recognized. It's another award. Again, we get them now and again. This was awarded the Project of the Year for a public works project less than $5 million. Now, here's the beauty of this. This was recognized as a really, really good project by people who do projects all the time. That means a lot. If you know anything about me, you know in my other life I'm a cabinet maker. The biggest compliment that I can get is another woodworker to look at my work and say, wow, I don't know if I could have done that. That's really good. That's what this was. This bridge was done that well. It's kind of, I think, it's the way we do things. We like to do them well, but then just a little bit of extra so that the community is a better place and there's a certain aesthetic element also. Drive down that bridge at night sometime. Drive down now in the wintertime when this Christmas decorations are up. It's charming. So it was a bridge that was falling apart, built in the 30s. It's now a bridge that's meant for decades ahead and adds the charm also. So I'm very proud of that award. Again, it was given by people who know what they're looking at. And the people who actually built the bridge are the ones that put us in for the award. They were that proud of their project. That's the kind of people we get to work in town. Next, Route 56. Okay, any season, pick any season and drive through town on 56 and tell me it doesn't look nice. Ride your bike or walk through the intersection of Batavia Road and Butterfield Road and know that you're safe. Path connects now into Blackwell. Path goes all the way along Butterfield Road. I mean, the transformation of that project from what it was to what it is now is just phenomenal. A lot of kudos to our staff. Who spent hours in meetings with IDOT. Understand IDOT, they're engineers. We got to move people. We want to get them there safely. We want to get them there quickly. Don't bother us with the aesthetics. Don't bother us with all this other stuff that's important to the community. We had to fight and fight and fight, meeting after meeting, reminding them again and again, hey, you promised you'd do this. Hey, you promised you would do that. And the result is phenomenal out there. Again, every season, the landscaping makes it attractive. And it invites people to get out of their cars and ride their bike and walk along the paths. So a huge project from my perspective. Getting excited to find out what one is yet? Number four. If you're a long-time Warrenville person, I mean really long time, like my parents, when it rained in Warrenville, there were parts of Warrenville that flooded every single time. There were just low areas. There was a huge problem. Little by little over the years, those had been addressed, but the river was still a huge problem. We still had significant flooding and the big events. We have worked with the county over the past several years with a number of different projects that have mitigated flooding to the point now when I talk to people that live along the river and there's a huge rain, they say, boy, the river doesn't come up as high and it goes down quicker. That was a huge project in terms of collaboration. And most of the money for those river enhancements and improvements, again, was outside money, county money and grad money. The Warrenville Road Bridge actually acted as a dam, the old bridge. There were old abutments under that bridge that had not been cleaned out. If you went down there during a huge event, the water would be a foot higher on the north side than the south side. It was flooding, helping to flood Warrenville. There was a kink in the river right before the bridge. Now it's been remeandered so there's a gentle curve. So the water flows faster, it's not obstructed by the bridge. So that's one of the major things we did. We worked with the Forest Preserve District to have them clear out areas in front of the Fairwell Dam that had been overgrown that also impeded the flow of the water. We worked with the county to change the operation of the dam so it was more favorable to Warrenville without hurting Naperville. Because obviously the dam protects Naperville, but it doesn't flood Warrenville. We determined what needed to be done to mitigate flooding in Warrenville. We cooperated with outside agencies, we found outside money, and we got it done, and the river is a much better place than it's been in 100 years. Not to mention the cleanup, which is another aspect of the river. It's more beautiful, it's more accessible. So I'm very proud of the fact that we're able to have flood mitigation and clean the river up also. Number three. This means a lot. If you live here and you have kids, if you do business here, being safe is a big thing. And to be recognized again, at three different occasions, we were recognized as one of the safest in the state. That's pretty good. Chief Toronto, 10 years, right, Chief? He'd done a remarkable job in 10 years. I'm not sure that was the case 10 years ago. I'm pretty sure it wasn't. But our department is professional, and they know what they're doing, and they do a great job, and that's one of the results. I'm very proud of that. So thank you, Chief. Number two, and District 200 people left. Tell them about it, okay? Oh, Bill's still here. Never mind, Bill. You got to carry the torch. Hubble Middle School. How can you not like that? We have three great schools in Warrenville now. This one is the Starship, LEED certified at the, what, bronze level? Gold level. LEED certified at the gold level. A beautiful site, a beautiful school. Wheaton kids come there, Warrenville kids go there, everybody goes, wow, this is fabulous. It's a beautiful school, a beautiful venue for us. And of course, the real beauty is that even though it was a fight to get it, it's there now, and it's going to be there forever. So it's part of our community, a hugely successful part of our community, and it shows what can be done if you work hard enough and you push hard enough and you never give up. And I'm very proud of the fact that we have that in town. And now, if you've checked off the boxes, you know what the last one is, right? I keep coming back to that because it's so unusual and you just don't find it. We try to spend your money wisely on every level, and we will continue to do that. So when you talk to people from other towns, be sure to say, hey, how are you guys doing? You know, you got any debt over there? Because we have none. All right, did anybody pick that as number one? Look at that. I know my citizens. We're all proud of that, I think, that it's very unusual. Anybody with some ideas of something that wasn't on my list that they'd like to say? I'd like to hear, you know, if you thought of anything else that I missed. Yes, Karen. The library, yep. That's doing a significant expansion and rebuilding over there now. Another venue that no matter what time you come by, when they're open, the parking lot's full, the lights are on, there are people inside. Thank you, that's excellent, that's a good one. Anybody else? One more. Can I get one more? Yes.
We're biased, but we think the Proton Center is quite an accomplishment for a small community. It was a joy to do that with you, and we're doing gangbusters
there, saving lives. That's another good one. And the Oncology Center that's now there also. Both of those are good for you, good for your patients, and good for our town because you bring so many people to our town where they can stay and spend some money. Sorry, I always think about that. I can't, you know. Thank you. That's a very good one. We're very appreciative that you're here. Somebody else had a hand up. I saw another hand. Yes.
John Nelson, Interim.
Excellent, excellent. An example of our HOAs that do a great job for us. Thank you so much for taking on that responsibility. And I didn't hear the interim part. I heard you say you wanted to do it a long time. Larry.
Being an old postal guy, I think having our doctor here is a big deal.
Yep. They've evolved into a completely different company at this point, right? They don't do anything of what they used to do, as far as I know. Yeah. That's one of our Cantera business citizens, and we're very glad to have them. Yeah, another good one. One more shot.
Warrenville and Bloom.
All right, yeah. That's another good one. Thank you. Yeah, very good. I guess if I had to pick the one thing that I've heard the most positive comments from people unsolicited, it'd be, boy, the town looks really nice this year. Great job. Yeah, very good. Thank you. Yes. I should have asked you when I made the list. Good one. Summer days in 4th of July. I know people that come to our 4th of July celebration because of the parade, because it's the quintessential small town parade, and they drive for miles to come to Warrenville to see the parade and then to go to Cerny Park afterwards where they can find a place to park. It's safe, it's quiet, it's fun, it's family friendly, there's music, all those good things. Thank you. Excellent. Summer Day is the same thing. Bringing people together from outside of town for a low-key, small-town, enjoyable get-together. Very good. Thank you. Well, oh, wait. Hey, we're going. We're on a roll.
The Hometown Happenings newsletter.
I swear I didn't plant him out there. Thank you. Yes. Yeah, very good. Thank you. Yes, another good one. Excellent. Yes.
Well, I serve on, I'm Janice Anderson. I serve on the county board with the mayor on the Stormwater Commission. So I represent a very small part of Warrenville, but I'm happy to be here. Thank you for the invitation. I do come to the parades every year on 4th of July. We do spend money here, and I live on the north side, so I'm really close to Cantera. So yes, we do spend a lot of money, but and I ride my bike, and usually we stop at Town Tap. So,
there you go.
I'm representing you, and I'm glad, very happy that our mayors got together and stopped that annexation, the silly annexation.
Yeah. We love Naperville. We just don't want to be Naperville. I don't know if I could say this in City Hall, but the most succinct, to-the-point comment that a citizen made to me about that potential annexation was, one, no. Two, hell no. I don't think it was a serious effort. Who knows? We still haven't figured out who's behind that. There are a lot of people that are speculating who did it. It makes absolutely no sense on any level. I mean, every community has its own culture, for one thing. Ostensibly, it was to create a more even tax base or lower taxes, but boy, I'll tell you, that's such a complicated issue that once they started digging into that, because so many taxing bodies are not coterminous with the cities, and oh, there's so much overlap, it would just be a nightmare. It was totally impractical, so it had to be some sort of a political shenanigans type thing, but they sure got a lot of publicity. And we got a lot of positive publicity, I thought, as a community, because there was a lot of pride. A lot of people said, no way, Warrenville is my home. I live here because I choose to live here. And I guess that's what I'll close on, is that we have a great little town. I'm happy to be able to report the good things that are going on, that have been going on, that will continue to go on, if I have anything to say about it. And we're always going to be Warrenville. We're never going to be anybody else. And I very much appreciate your attention and your participation this evening. It was so good to see all of you. And there are still goodies out there, so. Oh, yeah, turn your papers in. Don't walk off with them so we can do a little poll later and see what we've got.
What a great job.
Was that good? You like it?
And I will tell you, I even put my name in. I wanted you to see. How close.
Huh?
I was only off by one on virtually all of those things. So
excellent.
I appreciate that we think the same.
Thanks, David.